Fellowship Hall has been a little bit sparse. We've moved people.
Now you can throw me out of your office. I just
Ben! a little sparse. Out of my office, Ben, right now! Well, good evening, church family. Good to see you. Assuming that it's evening, maybe you're watching this in the morning or the afternoon. Either way, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. I hope you're doing well. Hope you're looking forward to maybe coming to church this Sunday. We had a great time last Sunday with the three areas open, the Courtyard Fellowship Hall and the Worship Center. Fellowship Hall has been a little bit sparse, a lot of room left in there. If you are so inclined to want to be kind of in the overflow area and meet there. Last couple Sundays, we've moved a lot of people from there into the Worship Center because we had a little extra space. So you want to take a gamble that you might be one of those moved in, who knows? Anyway, I hope that you will consider coming to church. As we're getting ready for this Sunday, Ben's going to have a few announcements for you, a few directions for you at the end of this. What I'd like to do is just talk with you a little bit about choices. One of the things that is true for us is that we make choices every day. You've made many choices today already, or you will. We all make choices all the time, constantly. Some of those choices are very important choices. Some are very trivial and pretty simple. But the reality is that we all make choices every day. And one of the books of the Bible that I think helps us to have a good perspective on choice making is the book of Ecclesiastes. It's my favorite book in the Old Testament. Being an analytical sort of guy, I really appreciate Solomon's approach to how he comes at viewing life and viewing purpose and viewing meaning and really seeking to understand as best as he can with that special wisdom that he was given by God to grasp these things, to grasp meaning and purpose, just what life is in its essence, and is there anything behind it, or are we just here? And in light of that, what I want to ask you, what I want to challenge you with is this question: is do your choices matter? And that's a question that very easily most of us would say, well, sure they matter. Some choices don't matter, some choices do matter. Coke, Pepsi, some would say, it doesn't really matter. It matters a lot. You should choose Pepsi, but it's up to you. There are often times places where we may view our choices as just not really that big of a deal, just not that important, because they're just smaller, or they're meaningless, or they're just kind of on that periphery, and we don't really have any reason to think about the choices that we make in some ways. And then other choices that are major choices in life, we'll give a lot of thought, a lot of prayer to. What I want to encourage you with is just the idea that your choices make a difference. They matter, even the smaller ones. Some of those ones that we'll make very quickly, just in an instant, those choices matter. And that we ought to be thoughtful about how we approach the different things that come up in our lives that we have to make decisions about. Because we make them all the time. We make them, as I said, every day. And they all are going to have some consequences. As we look at the different decisions that we're making, some choices, some decisions we make are good and they will have good results. Some choices and decisions are going to be bad. And they will oftentimes have bad consequences to them. Occasionally, we may make a bad decision that may actually turn out okay, just by God's providence. Sometimes we will make good choices, good decisions, and there may be an outcome that we didn't desire, that wasn't, in our view, good or what we were expecting. But all these things are working together in God's plan and God's purposes. As we look at life, one of the things that I can share with you is I've seen a lot of people, being involved in youth ministry especially, I've seen a lot of people make a lot of choices. As young people are getting into adulthood, they begin to make all kinds of different choices about college, about careers, you know, what they want to pursue, about marriage, about who their friends are going to be, who their close friends are going to be, what their priorities are, etc. Things of that nature that are a lot of major decisions. I've seen a lot of wise choices made. I've seen a lot of poor choices made. Good choices will oftentimes result in a good job or a good career. They will result in a good marriage, good family situations, good friendships that develop and strengthen and deepen. A good, strong church life, a good church family life, good ministry opportunities. They result in a lot of joy in our lives, a lot of contentment in our lives when we're making choices that God would deem good and wise. But I've also seen a lot of bad choices that have been made, about a lot of bad decisions that have resulted in broken relationships, friendships that have ended when they really didn't need to. There was no reason for it. It was just somebody's decision to do that. Families have split. There's been a lot of anger, a lot of dissatisfaction, a lot of animosity. People have found themselves very empty. A lot of times, even resulting in deeper things happening, deeper emotional issues that people will have because of choices that they have made. And so what I want to encourage you with today is that your choices are going to be impactful in your life. Sometimes even the smaller ones. Sometimes those split-second ones that you just don't think much about, but you just make a quick decision about. So I want to share with you just a little bit about Solomon and how his approach to this might help us, how his approach to looking at life may help us in our desire to make wise decisions in our lives, make wise choices in our lives. Solomon in his life, some of you know, as a young man, he followed God for a period of time. God blessed him with incredible wisdom. God had him become just the wealthiest, the most successful, from a worldly standpoint, king in all of Israel. And then he started making some poor decisions. He started marrying all these wives that were given to him by other nations and whatnot. He started following after their religions and following these false teachings, and went on with that in his life for a couple of decades. And then at the end of that, he looked back on his life and he writes this book of Ecclesiastes that we have here. And as he looks back, as he writes this at the end of a long journey, he can look back and he can see his life where he followed God and things went really well and things were good and he had a right mindset about himself. And then he can look at the times where he was not following God. He was walking away and making decisions there, making choices there that were not in line with good, godly, biblical wisdom and insight. And as Solomon was looking back, as he was reflecting and writing this, and I know many of you are familiar with the book of Ecclesiastes, but let me just read part of chapter 1 and refresh us about where he was, what he was thinking as he begins to write this, in terms of just looking at life and looking at meaning and purpose and how he should perceive things. He begins chapter 1, verse 2. He says, "Vanity of vanities, says the preacher. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity." Great place to start. Super encouraging way to begin a message, right? Everything's pointless. Everything's vain. There's nothing that is without, that has any kind of meaning or point to it at all. Great way to start a message to people. He says, "What does man gain by all the toil at which he toils under the sun? A generation goes and a generation comes, but the earth remains forever. The sun rises and the sun goes down and hastens to the place where it rises. The wind blows to the south, goes around to the north. Around and around goes the wind, and on its circuits the wind returns. All streams run to the sea, but the sea is not full. To the place where the streams flow, they flow again. All things are full of weariness. A man cannot utter it. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor the ear filled with hearing. What has been is what will be, and what has been done is what will be done, and there is nothing new under the sun. Is there a thing of which it is said, 'See, this is new'? It has been already in the ages before us. There is no remembrance of former things, nor will there be any remembrance of later things yet to be among those who come after." Solomon begins his letter by saying, man, there's just no point to anything. All of this is just weariness as he's thinking about it. And he uses that phrase, which he uses often in the book of Ecclesiastes, that phrase under the sun, where he's taking a look at life, taking a perspective as if there's no God, just looking at the horizontal, looking at things under the sun, looking at things here on this earth from just an earthly perspective, not with God in mind. There are times in the book of Ecclesiastes where he changes that. He changes to a godly perspective, a view of there is a God and it does matter. But a lot of what he writes is from this perspective of you know what? I inclined my mind to wisdom. I tried everything. And he's king, right? He can do whatever he wants. He can make whatever laws he wants. He can try everything he wants to try. And he says, I did. I tried everything. I sought after everything to see, you know, what's gonna provide meaning, what's gonna provide purpose, what's gonna fulfill me. And he says, nothing satisfied. Nothing satisfied. He made choices to view things without God in perspective, and he seeks after happiness, he seeks after fulfillment, and he finds nothing. Do you find yourself doing that from time to time, where you're seeking after something, you're choosing to go after something, thinking that is what's going to bring you purpose, that is what will fulfill you, that is what will finally satisfy you? Well, Solomon says, if God's not in the picture at all, in regards to that pursuit, it will be empty. There will be no point to it. There will be no satisfaction that will come to it. If it is, it'll be fleeting. You'll be satisfied for a moment, and then you will no longer be. And it won't be enough. And you'll have to chase after the next thing, and then the next thing, and then the next thing. That's why he says it's a wearisome task. It's a wearisome thing. In chapter 2, he goes on and he says, look, the best that a man can do is eat and drink and be merry. And uses that phrase about five times. He says, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. Again, not a super encouraging message that he brings, that he gives at that point. Again, his perspective being under the sun, without God. Sometimes we can get caught up in taking that perspective, in viewing things in this life, and thus making choices, making decisions in this life, without God in our perspective, without thinking about God being in our view, just from an earthly perspective, an earthly viewpoint. We're always making a mistake when we do that, because God is intimately involved in every aspect of what is going on in this world. God is in absolute sovereign control over all of it, including all aspects of your life and my life. And so we need to be seeking to be as biblical as we can, as wise as we can, according to God and His Word, in all of the decisions that we are making, all the pursuits that we go after, all the choices that we are making in our life, in the big decisions as well as the smaller ones. That can be hard, I know, because it means we have to be training our brain to be responding that way, to be thinking that way. And as shared with you before and shared with our students often, the way we think affects the way we act. So if we're thinking right, we're going to be acting rightly. If we're thinking wrongly, we're going to be acting wrongly. So we have to be very mindful about how it is that we are pursuing each aspect of decision-making in our lives. What are we trying to attain? What is our goal for what we're doing? What is our desired end for that? Is it just, I just want to be happy, so I want this thing? Or is it, I want God to be glorified? That has to come into play in your thinking and in my thinking as we move forward. Solomon basically got down to a point where it came down to two things. Either there's no God, or God just doesn't matter, and then nothing matters. Nothing matters. You just make whatever choices you want to try to make yourself as happy as you can be for the life that you have, however long or short that is. Just do the best you can. Be as happy as you can be. Make choices based on that, because nothing matters. So if you hurt people, you hurt people. Doesn't matter. If you have to step on people to climb up the corporate ladder, step on them. Doesn't matter. You need to get what you want. That's Solomon's perspective if there's no God. But he says if there is a God, then everything matters. Everything matters. At the end of Ecclesiastes, Solomon, as he concludes his letter in chapters 11 and 12, he really begins to spin things around and say, look, this under the sun perspective, this view of making choices and decisions and looking at life as if there's, as if there is no God, is foolishness. That is not wise to do, and we should not do that at all. And then in chapter 12, at the very end of his letter, he says, the end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every deed into judgment with every secret thing, whether good or evil. Solomon gets to the end of his thesis, the end of his story here, the end of this book. And he said, look, here's the bottom line. The bottom line is this. There is a God. You ought to fear him and keep his commandments. This is what we're called to do, to know God, to honor God, to follow God. And he says, part of the reason that we do that is because God's going to judge you. He's going to judge me. And he says he's going to judge everything, even the secret things, even the things that people don't know about, whether they're good or evil. He'll determine. He will judge that. And so we need to be mindful of that, even in the smaller choices that we make, or those medium-level choices that we may make. Don't just reserve praying to God for wisdom and direction for the big things in your life. Seek his wisdom, seek his guidance, seek biblical counsel, even in the smaller things, even in the things that may seem to be a lesser important type of decision. Because ultimately our goal is to honor God and to glorify him in everything that we do. You know, as Paul wrote to the Corinthians, whether we eat or drink, as he wrote to the Colossians, in all word and deed, Paul says in both of those places, we are to glorify God in even some of the small things that we do, the small decisions that we make. You have decisions coming up in a few weeks here about how to vote on different propositions for different people. Are you seeking wisdom, biblical wisdom, about those choices? Or are you just checking boxes? Do you just get one of those, you know, voter pamphlets that says, you know, hey, so-and-so, this agency says vote this way. And you just go, okay, check, 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 check. Or do you really look into the opportunity that you have to cast a vote with wisdom, with knowledge, with understanding? I would encourage you to do that. You may have a decision about whether you're going to come to church this Sunday or not. And I would encourage you, if you're able and you're comfortable with the COVID virus, come to church Sunday. We can accommodate quite a few people, almost 300 people between the two services. We've got more room. And as I mentioned, the fellowship hall has been a little bit sparse the first couple weeks. So let's come back to church. You have choices about that. You have choices to make about how you're going to love your family, how you're going to respond to your children, or how you're going to respond to your spouse in that heated moment when you may be busy with something and they ask you a question. How are you going to respond to them? With love and gentleness and kindness? Or are you going to snap and say, I'm busy right now, why don't you? You get what I'm saying. Little choices like that. How are you going to speak to people? How are you going to speak about people? You know, right now, our country is very divided in a number of ways. How are you going to talk to people who are on the other side that have a different view than you? Are you going to seek to speak with them lovingly? As Paul tells us in Ephesians 4, speak the truth in love. Are you going to do that? Or are you just going to yell at them, tell them how wrong they are about their position and just say, blah, 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 and you're an idiot? Not the best way for us to speak Christ into people's lives. So make choices, make decisions about all these things, how you're going to speak. Does truth matter to you? You know, as it comes down to points of theology, understanding how best to respond to this whole COVID situation that we're in, as we're talking about politics with people, are we speaking truthfully? And does truth matter to you, or does only your opinion matter? Because you and I both have opinions, and they may not mean anything if there's no truth behind them. And not just a little truth, but they should be fully true as best as we're able to formulate our views, our opinions around what we know to be true based on information that we can gather and based primarily on what does God tell us? How does God help us? How does God instruct us? Your decision tonight may be as simple as cheese or no cheese on your burger. And it probably should be cheese. I'll leave you with that, church family. We love you. We're praying for you. Continue to pray for us as your elders. A lot of things that we still have on the plate that we have to talk about as we're just trying to unfold all of this and the different changes that are going to be coming about hopefully soon as we get maybe down to our next tier in a couple weeks. So keep praying for us. We'll keep praying for you. We love you very much. Make wise choices. Submit your decisions to God. They all matter, especially if you're seeking to glorify Him in even the little things. Not just the big ones, but even the small ones. Okay. Go with that tonight. God bless you.